Good morning, everyone. My name is Kate. Welcome to our Every Nation Tswane Willows service. I'm so glad that you can join us this morning on this online platform. And I want to say a special welcome to anyone who's joining us for the very first time. We are a disciple-making family, and we'd love to get you connected into discipleship. And so if you are visiting, I'd like to ask you to go to our Every Nation Tswane website, click on the Join a Weekly Connect Group button, and someone will contact you this week just to welcome you and give you some more info on our discipleship groups. I also want to celebrate with those of us who have had life events this week. Maybe you've had a birthday or an anniversary, found out you're pregnant, got engaged, whatever it may be. I'd really love to pray with you now and just celebrate your life with you. So let's pray. Father, thank you that I can pray for our family, Lord, those that have had birthdays and celebrations in their lives. Lord, I pray this morning as they're listening to this prayer that they would just experience your love in this moment. Lord, I pray that they would experience your goodness towards them and that their hearts would just be filled with all of the good things that you have for them. Lord, I pray that they would have hope for the year ahead of them and for the future ahead of them, Lord, and that they would know that you are God and that you have them in the palm of your hand. So we just pray blessings over them, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Great. So, family, I just have two announcements for you this morning. And the first one is our prayer and fast week that's coming up on the 1st to the 5th of February. Now, every year, our Every Nation Global family sets aside time in the beginning of the year just to pray and fast as a family, to seek God and to honor God with this week and to consecrate the year ahead of us to God. And as an Every Nation family, a Tswane family, we will be praying and fasting together, like I said, from the 1st to the 5th of February. Now, there are devotions that go along with this prayer and fast week, and I want to ask you to please save the date, but also keep an eye on our Facebook page as well as our WhatsApp discipleship groups for more information so that you don't miss out. Previously, in previous years, we've experienced so many testimonies of God coming through for people, breakthroughs, miracles, just word that God's given people, and it's been an incredible time. So don't miss out. Join us in this prayer and fast time. Our second announcement is that I'd love to invite you to join us for something that we are doing as a Willows congregation for the first time, and that is our Purple Book class. Now, many of you will know that the Purple Book is a book that focuses on establishing biblical foundations in our lives. And this time we are going to do it together, not only in our Connect groups, but as a much bigger group. And so you are invited to join us. Doesn't matter if you've done it before or not, but we're going to be doing this Purple Book class over 12 sessions throughout 2021, 12 different sessions. And our first session is coming up on Monday, the 8th of February, 7:30 to 9 p.m. And we want to invite you to join us. Now, we do have limited space, and so we'd like to ask you to please register so we can send you all the information that you need to join us online. But I personally am so excited to do this course. I believe it is really going to add value to our lives this year. My family, we're going to go into a time of worshiping God through song, and the worship team is going to lead us in that. But I want to encourage you. I believe God wants to encourage your heart this morning. So I encourage you to, wherever you are, just engage your heart, worship God, thank Him for who He is, because He is good. And I pray that you will enjoy the service with us this morning.
Goeiemôre, good morning, family and friends. Welcome to our online worship session. Why don't you stand up, do whatever you do during worship, and join us as we worship God.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was mighty till I made. I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried to hide. It was mighty till I made you. 'Cause when you called my name and I ran out of that Citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing. Oh, your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future, my eyes are open. It's when you call my name, and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness, into your
sad.
satisfies my soul, and I never ever have to be afraid. This one thing remains. This one thing remains. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love. Ooh. In death, in life, I'm confident and covered by the power of your great love. My death is free, there's nothing that can separate my heart from your great love. In death, in life, I'm confident and covered by the power of your great love. My death is free, there's nothing that can separate my heart from your great love. It never runs out on me. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. It never runs out on me. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love never runs out. When we run away, we run into you, 'cause your love never runs out. Oh, oh. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love. To the one, to the Lamb, to our King upon the throne, to the Christ, to our Savior, to the risen Son of God, blessing in all. From our hearts to the heavens. For your glory we proclaim. Blessing in honor, glory and power. Salvation belongs to our God. Blessing in honor.
Thank you, Lord, that you are good, that you're a good Father, you're a good God. And thank you, Lord, that as a holy God, you're involved in our lives. And we just pray that you'll open the hearts of the people watching and bless the word. Amen.
Good morning to our Every Nation Tswane Willows congregation. Also from my side, it's great to share today's message with you. And what a great privilege we have to know that our God is not confined to a certain time and space, and that we can worship God wherever we find ourselves, in every season and any time of the day. And therefore, I really trust and pray that even now when we're going to spend time in His Word, that it will be a form of worship unto Him, that we don't just go through the motions, but that you would experience God ministering to you, that by His Spirit and through His Word, that He would do certain things in your lives, and that you would experience Him as a personal God. Now, last week we started with a new sermon series called Awesome God. And in the beginning of every year, we as an international spiritual family unite around a certain theme. And then for a couple of weeks, we preach on this theme or on certain topics in line with this theme. And we dedicate a specific week to pray and fast together. Now, this year's theme is Awesome God. And the idea behind this series is that we want to explore the awesomeness of God by looking at certain encounters between God and people. Now, in each one of these encounters, God, a certain name is given to God, and through this name, a certain attribute of God is highlighted or demonstrated. Now, a name is important. There are certain associations that comes with a name. These associations can be good or bad. For instance, if I say Mauritius, what picture comes to mind? What idea comes to mind? I trust that for most of us, that's a good association, a good idea. Unless you had a vacation in Mauritius and it rained the whole time and there was a storm and you got food poisoning, then you might not have a good association with that name. The question we need to ask ourselves, what association do we make in our minds when we say, Awesome God? What comes to mind? What do we think about? And my prayer for each one of us is as we engage in this series, as we look at this topic and look at the names of God, that we'll get to learn God in a more personal way, that we'll get to experience and not just study, but experience certain attributes of God, and that we'll have a good association with the name, an awesome God. And I want to encourage you, let's open our hearts in this season to explore the names of God and allow Him to reveal those attributes to each one of us personally. Now this morning, the specific encounter that we're going to look at is the encounter between a man called Gideon and God. And we find this encounter in the book of Judges, chapter 6. And I want to really encourage you that you would, from your own Bible, follow and read together with me. Now before we do that, I just want to give us a little bit of background as to what is happening in Judges. Now, the nation of Israel were slaves in Egypt. And God saw that and He had pity on them. And then through a man called Moses, the leader of Israel, God did miraculous signs and wonders, and He freed Israel from the oppression of Egypt. And He led Israel through the Red Sea into the desert. And here in the desert, God revealed Himself to the nation of Israel through more signs and wonders. And God started revealing Himself in such a way that He was training Israel to become the people of God. He was training them not to be slaves, but to be the men and women of God. And they experienced God in a specific and a significant way. But then Moses, the leader of Israel, passed away, and another man called Joshua took over the leadership from him. And Joshua was the actual leader who led Israel into the promised land, into the land that God has predestined for them, into the place that God has prepared them for. And this land's name is Canaan. And Joshua led the Israelites into Canaan. And in Canaan, they had many victories and they seized the land and they were settling within Canaan. But Joshua passed away. And now a couple of years have passed and there's not been a new leader for Israel. And that's where the book of Judges takes place. Now what's happened, Israel has grown so accustomed to living in Canaan that they've started to forget the ways of God. They started to embrace the culture of the people. And they started to live more like people of Canaan than people of God. And slowly but surely, they drifted. And they compromised and compromised and compromised in just the way that God has called them to live. And now they find themselves where they are in complete disobedience towards God. And from this place, God has just lifted his hand of favor from them. And he has allowed a different nation, the Midianites, to start to oppress the Israelites again. And now after a season of oppression, God wants to change this. He's heard their cries and he now wants to save Israel again. And he's going to do this by raising up a leader. And that's where we find ourselves. God is now going to engage with Gideon. So before we read together, let's pray and ask God to lead us in this. Father, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for your word. Lord, you know us personally. You know where we're finding ourselves. And Lord, I pray that by your Spirit that you will help us to just discern, even in this encounter where you had with Gideon, where do we find ourselves? Lord, help us to discern what do you want to do in this season? What do you want to say to us? And Lord, in your grace, may you come and reveal yourself to us through your word. Lord, I pray for every person that's watching this, Lord, that you would now just settle their hearts, calm their minds, and align our thoughts to what you want to do in this moment. Lord, we thank you and we declare again, it's not about us, it's about you. May your perfect will be done in and through our lives. Amen. So let's read together. This is Judges 6 from verse 11. The angel of the Lord came and sat down under the oak in Ophrah that belonged to Joash the Abiezrite, where his son Gideon was threshing wheat in a winepress to keep it from the Midianites. Now, we find Gideon threshing wheat in a winepress. This is weird. This is strange. This is not something that you would expect, because threshing wheat was separating the edible grain or edible crops from the scaff or the straw. And this was done by beating it or stamping on the crops on a threshing floor, an open space, an open flat space. But that's not what Gideon is doing. Gideon is secretly doing this threshing of the wheat inside a wine press. Not only is this ineffective for what he wants to do, but it also shows us what is going on in Gideon's life. Gideon is fearful and anxious, and he's afraid that if the Midianites were to see what he's doing, they would come down and take him captive or destroy the crops or hurt, maybe even hurt him. He's hiding. He's fearful. And he's just isolating himself inside this winepress in fear of what might happen. Verse 12. When the angel of the Lord appeared to Gideon, he said, "The Lord is with you, mighty warrior." Now, I love how God approaches Gideon. Mighty warrior. I think this is the last thing that Gideon would have said about himself. I don't think Gideon is viewing himself here in the wine press, hiding from the Midianites, as a mighty warrior. And yet, that's the way that God addresses him. See, God is not associating Gideon with what he's doing. God is speaking into Gideon's life and he's calling into being that what he's seeing in Gideon. Mighty warrior. And God is calling forth a different identity in Gideon. Something that God views that Gideon might not be viewing or seeing himself. Again, I think this is the last way that Gideon saw him. As a mighty warrior. This morning I want to ask the question, how do you view yourself? When you think about yourself, when your name comes up, what association do you make? And more importantly, how do you think God views you? What do you think comes to mind when God looks at you in your life? God viewed Gideon differently. He saw a mighty warrior. But listen how Gideon responds to God. In verse 13. "Pardon me, my lord," Gideon replied. "But if the Lord is with us, why has all this happened to us? Where are all his wonders that our ancestors told us about when they said, 'Did not the Lord bring us up out of Egypt?' But now the Lord has abandoned us and given us into the hand of Midian." The Lord turned to him and said, "Go in the strength you have and save Israel out of Midian's hand. Am I not sending you?" "Pardon me, my Lord," Gideon replied, "but how can I save Israel? My clan is the weakest in Manasseh, and I am the least in my family." Gideon is so focused on his realities and his fears that he is missing what God wants to do in this moment. He's so focusing on what's not happening and their immediate circumstances that he's not hearing what God is saying to him. And instead of listening to God, instead of seeing what God wants to do, maybe in his ignorance, he starts to accuse God. Where's God? Why aren't God doing anything? Why are we in this situation? He starts to blame God. He starts to doubt the promises of God. He questions God's way. And he's completely missing God in this moment. In fact, Gideon goes as far as to give reasons as why he cannot obey God, why he cannot respond to what God is calling him to. "I am the least. My clan cannot do this." And he's giving reasons to disobey God. Friends, we need to be really, really careful in this season that we don't do exactly the same as Gideon. That we don't get so distracted and so focused on our fears and our anxieties and our immediate circumstances that we miss what God wants to do. That we miss God in this season. We need to be careful that we're not so focused on social media and news and statistics and conspiracies and fake news and whatever we're focusing and turning our attentions to that we cannot hear the voice of God in this season. In the midst of our current realities, we cannot miss what God wants to do and what God is saying. Because we might, like Gideon, ignorantly start to question God. Where's God? Why is God allowing this? Why is God not coming through? We might start to doubt the promises of God and start to harbor disbelief in our lives. We might even start to give reasons as why we do not have to follow Jesus in this season. Why we don't have to be faithful with what God has entrusted us with. Why don't we have to obey His word? Just giving reasons. Doubting God. Doubting His promises. Giving reasons not to obey. So this morning I want to appeal to us. There's this urgency in my heart. What are we focusing on? Is it just our circumstances? Or are we focusing on what God is doing? Are we intently listening for what He is saying? Friends, ask yourself, what is consuming your eyes? There's this great scripture in Isaiah 26 verse 3. It says, "You keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on you because he trusts in you." You keep him in perfect peace. We can experience perfect peace if we're focused, if our minds are steadfast on God and not our circumstances. Yes, our circumstances are real. Yes, there's certain things that we're facing that's true and it's difficult and it causes fear. We cannot deny these things. But God is still true. He's still alive. God is still at work, and God still has a purpose, and God still wants to speak to each one of us. And we cannot ignore God in the midst of our current circumstances. In fact, there's a great opportunity for us, and in the midst of this, to turn to God, to listen. What does God want to do in this season? What does He want to speak into your life? Look how Gideon responds to God. He doesn't recognize what God wants to do. He doesn't recognize what God is saying to them. And he's just starting to doubt God. And in spite of this, in spite of Gideon missing God and missing out on God and in ignorance accusing God, in spite of his disobedience, look how God responds to him. Verse 16, the Lord answered, I will be with you. What great comfort is this? I will be with you. See, God is faithful and trustworthy even when we're not. God's character cannot change. He's the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. And God assures Gideon, I will be with you. God calls him a mighty warrior. He gives him a calling, something to do. And God assures him, I will be with you. And Gideon responds to God. The Lord answered, I will be with you and you will strike down all the Midianites, leaving none alive. And Gideon replied, if now I have found favor in your eyes, give me a sign that is really you talking to me. Please do not go away until I come back and bring my offering and set it before you. And the Lord said, I will wait until you return. Gideon went inside, prepared a young goat, and from an ephod of flour he made bread without yeast. Putting the meat in a basket and its broth in a pot, he brought them out and offered them to him under the oak. The angel of God said to him, take the meat and the unleavened leavened bread, place them on this rock and pour out the broth. And Gideon did so. Then the angel of God touched the meat and the unleavened bread with the tip of the staff that was in his hand. Fire flared from the rock, consuming the meat and the bread, and the angel of the Lord disappeared. When Gideon realized that it was the angel of the Lord, he exclaimed, alas, sovereign Lord, I have seen the angel of the Lord face to face. But the Lord said to him, peace, do not be afraid, you are not going to die. So Gideon built an altar to the Lord there, and called it, the Lord is peace. So after this encounter, the name that is given to God is that of Jehovah Shalom. The Lord is peace. We have to ask the question, why is this the attribute that Gideon is lifting up in this moment? Why is this the attribute that is exposed in the name of God, the Lord of peace? See, Gideon has, from this encounter with God, been transformed from a heart of fear and anxiety to a heart of peace. Where he started off hiding, he's now at a place of worshiping, building an altar, worshiping God as the Lord of peace. Gideon experienced something specifically in this encounter with God that settled his heart and gave him peace. Now, I believe there's four things that happens in this encounter between God and Gideon that could have given Gideon peace. And I believe that gives us peace as well in how we experience God and what we experience from God. Firstly, there's a peace in how God viewed Gideon. God spoke over Gideon's life and he called him a mighty warrior. There's a peace in knowing that's how God viewed me. There's also a peace in God's word, where God gave his promise, I will be with you, Gideon. Then we can also find peace in God's greatness. See, God demonstrated his ability and his almightiness when he brought a consuming fire. And I'm imagining if I'm Gideon and that were to happen, I would be in awe of the might and the power of God. There's a peace in knowing God's greatness and his ability. But there's also a peace in knowing God's goodness. See, Gideon realized eventually that he saw face to face God, the angel of the Lord. And in that moment, the fear of the Midianites just not subsided, doesn't disappear, but there was a different fear that became more prominent. A fear of God, a healthy fear, a realization of the holiness of God. And the ancient Israelites believed that once you're exposed to the holiness of God, you will surely die as a human. And because of that holiness, there was an understanding in Gideon that because he experienced the holiness, the greatness of God, then surely he needs to die. And yet God says, I assure you, Gideon, you will not die. And Gideon experienced not only the greatness, but also the goodness of God. Gideon experienced mercy and grace in that moment. Now, how is this encounter between Gideon and God significant for us? And how can we experience this peace? How can we have this encounter with Jehovah Shalom, the Lord of Peace? If we fast forward to John 14, Jesus is teaching his disciples, and then Jesus says this beautiful words to his disciples. He says, peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled and do not be afraid. Jesus said to his disciples, to his followers, I give you a different peace than the peace that the world gives. See, the peace that the world offers us is like a house of cards. It's fragile and it can easily tumble in on itself. If we think about what are some of the things, some of these cards, this house of cards, that gives people peace. See, people find peace in feeling safe. Some people find peace in knowing they are accepted and loved by a certain group of people. Some people find peace in knowing that they can do whatever they want to do, that they can be in control, that they can control their circumstances. Knowing that their plans will work. Some people find peace in the ability to structure their lives and control certain outcomes of their lives. Some people find peace in having enough. Enough room, enough time, enough money, enough friends. Having enough. And what do you find peace? Because none of these things can give us lasting peace. But Jesus says, the peace that I give you is differently. See, because of the life of Jesus and the sacrificial obedience that he demonstrated, where he atoned for our sins through his life, we now have the privilege of being in relationship with the God of peace. See, we, like Gideon, can have daily encounters with God where we experience the peace of God. And for us today, there's a great comfort in knowing that God views us differently. There's a peace that we find in knowing how God views us. There's a scripture in 1 John verse 12 that says, yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Meaning that if we follow Jesus, we accepted Jesus as our Lord and Savior, we are the rightful children of God. And then everything that God says and speaks about His children in His Word becomes true for our lives. Everything that God speaks in general about His children is true for our lives. And that settles our heart, that brings us peace, that regardless of what we're doing, regardless of what we're facing, regardless of where we're failing, regardless of what people might be saying, God views us differently. God views us as conquerors, as people that have overcome. God views our lives as precious and valuable. God loves us. We are viewed differently. And that gives us peace. But there's also a peace in knowing God's greatness, knowing that we now have the privilege of to be in relationship with this holy God, an almighty God for whom nothing is impossible. We can bring our greatest challenges and our most difficult circumstances to God. And it's not just a hope that God can do something. It's an assurance that God is able to change it. That God is a miracle worker, that He's a way maker. There's a greatness of God that gives us peace, knowing that God is for us and not against us, and that He is all-powerful and almighty. But there's also peace in knowing that this holy God has already demonstrated His goodness towards us. And we don't have to fear Him. We don't have to fear His punishment. He's already given us His mercy and grace. He has already demonstrated His love to us. In Romans 5, we see how God says, even while we were still sinners, He demonstrated His love to us by giving His Son. There's a peace in knowing that God cares for us. He loves us. Our lives are valuable to Him. And there's a mercy and grace that we can find with Him. He is the Lord of peace. And friends, this morning, we need to ask ourselves, and where do we find our peace? And what do we trust to find peace? What are we focusing on this season? What are we putting our attention to? Are we so distracted by the things of the world that we might miss what God is doing and what God wants to say? Because from this place of peace, Gideon could step out and align his life with the purpose of God. Friends, God still wants to do great things in this season, and He's inviting us to align our lives to His purpose, to His calling, to His kingdom purpose. But we have the privilege of finding peace in Him, knowing that God views us differently, knowing that God's word is true, knowing His greatness and His goodness. I want to conclude this morning by sharing a picture when praying about the sermon and really trusting God that He would minister to us this morning and that He will settle our hearts and that He would bring peace. I saw a picture of a storm, and I was reminded that in the midst of the strongest or most fierce storm, there's an eye, the eye of the storm. And in the middle of this raging storm, there's a place of peace and calmness. And I just had this sense or the urgency in my heart that God is inviting us into that place. And God is saying, regardless of what storm you might find around you, regardless of what's raging around you, there's a place where you can center your life in God. And in the middle of this uncertain fear and anxiety and storms, there's a place where we can experience the peace of God. God is inviting us into that place. And because of Jesus, we can enter into the presence of God. Friends, I want to encourage us this morning. Let's turn to God. Like Gideon, let's just for a moment put the things of the world aside. And let's focus on God. And let's allow God to minister to our hearts. So remind ourselves of how God views you. Remind ourselves of God's promises. Remind ourselves of His greatness. And remind ourselves of His goodness. And then we'll experience His peace. If He is the Lord of peace and we are His children, then peace should be a mark of our lives. And that's my prayer for each one of us. By the grace of God, we will not only experience His peace, but that we'll live His peace in this difficult and uncertain world. Let's pray together. Father, this morning we want to acknowledge You as the Lord of peace. We want to acknowledge that apart from You, we cannot find lasting peace. And Lord, I even in this moment want to pray for every person that realizes that we've been maybe so focused on the things of the world that we've missed what You want to do. But we've been so distracted with things that have been consuming us, Lord, that we've not been able to hear Your voice. And Lord, this morning we want to repent of that. We want to say sorry. We want to say sorry that other things have allowed us not to focus on You. And by Your Spirit, may you lead us back. Lord, we want to place our focus and our eyes on You. Lord, we acknowledge again this morning, there's no one like You. Lord, we want to repent of any things that we've tried to find our peace in, Lord. Whether it be our comfort, our possessions. Lord, we just lay those things down and we say, we're sorry, Lord. Would You forgive us? And by Your mercy and grace, would You through Your Spirit empower us to live lives that honors You? Lord, would You come and meet us where we are? Would You reveal Yourself to us? Would You reveal how You view us, Lord? I pray that specifically this morning, for people that's really struggling with their identity, Lord, that You would come and reveal to them how You see them. Lord, come remind us of Your promises. Lord, I'm praying for miracles to happen in our lives. We're asking for Your greatness to be supreme in this season. But Lord, we also thank You and worship You that You're a merciful Father, a loving Father, full of goodness. Your word says that we should make our requests known to You, and then the peace of God will guard our hearts. Lord, may You send Your peace to us this morning. We pray this and ask this in Your wonderful name.